do consider using PCBWay for your next electronics project.
Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this video where we're going to talk about the American or USA electrical system. So let me just throw out an important note about this video. This video is in no way a tutorial on how to go and wire your house or home or what have you. It's merely to provide some kind of context for how the electrical wiring system works here in the States. I hope I don't make any mistakes. I think I've got it right, but if I do get anything wrong, please make a note. This is going to be based around household or domestic electrical systems, certainly not industrial. I'm also going to make some references to like the South African system and how it's different from South Africa. We'll also talk about electricians, because my advice to you is, again, don't use this as a tutorial in any way. You should go and get a qualified electrician. But at the end of this video, I'm going to talk about my experiences with qualified electricians and what they have and haven't done, certainly in my experience. And I'm going to call on your experiences as well. And say the one reason which prompted this video was because someone posed a question when I was looking at that pump saver device. They saw the color of the wiring and they made a statement or an assumption saying that something about the neutral and it being switched or not. And it was very good of them to raise that question, because when you see the color of the wiring, you're going to make a certain assumption. Like for instance, the color of the wiring in South Africa in your plugs is, this one doesn't happen to have an earth, but you've got a blue which is neutral and you've got a brown which is your live. And when you see a piece of equipment on my bench which has that, you're going to make certain assumptions. Now the transformers I bought here in the USA on Amazon, they're probably produced in China. And they have a color, they have a wiring system with a color code which doesn't conform to what the US is, and that can create confusion. So I thought this little video would add a bit of background, and then we can go through some interesting scenarios in terms of what could go wrong with the wiring coming into your house here in the States, because I've had first-hand experience of this when we were in our rental. And so I'll pose a little riddle to you, and then we'll go through possible scenarios. But anyway, let's get down to the bench. Righty-ho, so let us start at what happens coming into your domestic home. So over here, as a bit of a scraggle, this would be, let's say, one of the power poles or electrical poles on your street. It'll get a feed from a transformer. So ultimately, you're going to get the power coming in from an electrical company. They boost it up to quite a high voltage to cater for losses as it travels along the lines. It then goes to a substation or sub-transformer, which probably changes it down, and then it goes to the pole, and then you've got another transformer on that pole which will then take it down to the levels, voltage levels required for the household. So let's just have a look at what happens inside that transformer. So basically, coming into this transformer, you're going to have a primary, and although I've got this 240 volts measured across the side, it might not be 240 volts because they're transforming whatever they're bringing into this side onto this side. But you're going to have a primary coil and then a secondary, and off that secondary is where you get your 240 volts. But what they do, whereas the primary has just got two feeds into it, the secondary has a center tap. And that center tap is taken so that you divide. You've got a split across that 240 where you're going to get between that tap, which is your neutral, and line one, you're going to get 120 volts. And then between that neutral and line two, you're going to get 120 volts AC. Now, if you recall in a previous video I mentioned, it can be confusing because the voltage range has been changed in the US. It's changed all the way from 110 volts, I think, to 115, 117, and then it went to 120. So often you'll hear people referring to 115 or 110 volts because historically it was that. But currently, the voltage supply within a certain margin is about 120 volts. If you actually go and measure this, it can be out by a bit. That can differ depending on different times of the day. In fact, I've monitored
the voltage levels. If there's heavier load on the grid or in your neighborhood, you can see fluctuations. There are many reasons which can actually fluctuate the voltage level. But this is what we get coming into the household. The 120 volts is used for most of your appliances. So things like televisions, the outlets, power outlets in the walls and what have you, are for the most part running at 120 volts. But there are certain appliances which cannot get enough power because you can only pass so much current through normal household wiring. And 120 volts in that current doesn't give you really adequate power to run things like some washing machines or dryers, or for instance, an oven, stove, or range. And those will potentially run off 240 volts. And that's when they take a feed from line one, which is live, line two, which is live. We'll go at the end of this video, when I say live and live and a neutral, we'll talk about the potential for getting a shock on a neutral versus a live and what have you. So that is something we'll talk about later. But so coming off that transformer, you're going to have the that one live, noted as L1. That typically is should be black in coloring. Your neutral is white, and then your live two will be red. And those will come into a meter. And this little meter is obviously does the measurement to see how much you're consuming so that you can be charged. That often acts like a switch. And certainly in the electrical boxes which I've had here in the US, you get these wires coming into connectors, and that meter acts as the bridge to bridge it into your DB board or your breaker box inside your home. And in some cases, you can have a breaker box on the outside of your wall, and then so that you've got some electrical circuits on the outside. In fact, the main switch can be switched from the outside of your house, and I'll show you an example of this. And then you get a pass through into a panel inside your home. Now again, I want to reiterate about being wary about everything I'm saying here, because even a small subtle mistake here can be critical, and that's why you shouldn't use this as a guide to go and mess around with your electrical system or go and open your DB box and have it try and look at this yourself. It can be very dangerous. From there, you'll also have what is known as a protective ground. So you'll have a green or yellow or a mix of green and yellow wire which goes into ground as a level of safety protection. It can bring potentially any stray shorts or what have you down to ground. When these wires come through to the main panel or breaker box or DB board inside the house, this is traditionally how it's laid out in the US. You will have that L2 and L1. Between those, as noted, you've got 240 volts. They will come through a main break or main disconnect so that you can disconnect the service. And potentially get different kinds of services. I think probably that one of the most common services coming into a normal domestic home is a 200 amp service. It could be less, it could be more, depending on the size of the household. Off these, both of these conductors, which you can see here in the red and the black. Now, inside your breaker blocks, these obviously aren't going to be color-coded because they are either going to be made of aluminium or some other conductor or copper. But they are laid out in this like fork or comb-like manner with conductors going straight down and then these little tabs going cross in between. And if I show you a little insert of a breaker box where you can see this, you see the one I'm going to show you has got some covering across these. And the way this is laid out is so that when you insert a breaker, I'll just pull up an example. So this would be a typical breaker for a 120 volt circuit. You've got a little insert here clip which clips into that conductor. So that would pick up your main feed from that conductor, and then your wiring would come out of this end of the breaker and go to your appliance or your outlet or your lighting or whatever. So if you need 120 volts for an appliance, you just have a breaker going in and picking up one of those conductors, and the wiring would go out from there. If you have a larger appliance which needs 240 volts, That breaker, which has got a double pole inside, goes across one tab from L1 or L2, and then another tab from the other corresponding feed. So it'll have a tab, it'll bridge across L1 and L2. Now when I say bridge, it's not shorting those. The breaker goes across those, and it is switching a feed from L1 and a feed from L2. So that across that, it has 240 volts. Now the critical difference here between this 240 volts, let's say from, let's say, Europe or South Africa, is that there's no neutral. If we go back to our 120 volt feed, we'll have one conductor coming out from one of those feeds. Wiring will then come from one of these bus bars. So let's just quickly discuss these bus bars. Generally speaking, and again, this is a generalization because it can differ from breaker box to breaker box, you can have two bus bars in. One would be designated for your neutrals, and the other would be designated for your earth connections. But they will be, if it's in the main panel, and this is critical because it's different in a sub panel, but in your main panel, those will be connected or bonded together. So depending on your code, and again, this is where you need to be very careful, the electrical code might allow you to use either bus bar for your earth. So you could have a neutral and an earth coming off this bus bar, even though it might be designated an earth, and likewise for the neutral as well, because they are, in theory, at the same potential and bonded together. So if we're going to go to a 120 volt outlet, for instance, you'd have your feed from that breaker, you'd have then a wire going to that earth bus bar, and then your neutral could either come from the earth bus bar or the neutral bus bar, and those would go down to the outlet. So in this case, you do have that neutral. Now, when they come down to your outlet, I'll just show you what the US outlet looks like. So I've got it orientated this way. You'll see on this, you've got the hole at the top, which is your earth. You've got the smallest slot here on, which happens to be on the left, the way this is orientated. That'll be the live. And then you've got the bigger slot over here, which will be your neutral. And that's represented over here. And looking at the color coding, you could have a black, which is your live, or you could have a red. Now, traditionally, I've mostly seen in the electrical cables that I've used, if it's a normal domestic cable to run an appliance, it's going to be black for the live, and then a white for your neutral, and then obviously a green, yellow, or a mix for your earth. But potentially, you could have a red, which is live as well. So in this scenario, you do have a neutral, and your live is going to be carrying your AC, which is passes here. It would then pass through your load, and then the AC is returned through the neutral. And probably many folks who are in Europe or in Africa, for instance, this is what they're used to in their electrical system. In theory, now we're going to go and have a look at what can happen if you get outlets or appliances wired incorrectly, if you switch these two and what can go awry. But in theory, and this is a question people ask, if you touch a neutral, will you get a shock? And in theory, if everything is working correctly and everything is balanced, you won't. But often you can have loads which are on a neutral and you can have something slightly miswired, and there will be an electrical potential on the neutral and you can get a shock. So don't go around thinking you can touch the neutral and not get a shock. Potentially you can. Always treat electrical wiring as live unless you've got it switched off right at the breaker box. Switching it off at an outlet could still lead to problems, and that's what we'll talk about later. So that's going to your normal outlets in the wall running your normal appliances. Then if we switch over to the 240 volt appliances, you're going to have these two lives coming out of that breaker. Now they will come out, and here again you get different outlets for different appliances. You can get a three-prong 240 volt outlet, you can get a four prong, and you get different configurations. I'm just giving one example here of a four prong. And in this case, you'll have your two feeds, your two lives, your L1 and your L2 coming down to this. They should be color-coded as red for your L2, black for your L1, two lives. You'll have an earth coming to an earth pin. And then potentially what you can also have is a neutral coming out to one of the pins. You'll also see a labeling system on these types of plugs, Y, which would be L2, and X, which is L1, the G, which is the ground, and the W, which is your neutral. What this kind of outlet allows you to do is if you're running one of those big appliances, you'd connect it across L1 and L2. That would give you your 240 volts. But in some cases, you might have an appliance which uses both 240 volts and 120 volts. And in that case, you can use the wiring. If you go between L1 to neutral, you're going to get your 120 volts, or L2 to neutral, you'll get your 120 volts. So going back to the system here, but you're doing it on this side with a 240 volt feed. So that gives you some versatility. But in this case, like I had on my bench, if I just have a system where I've got L1 and L2, both of those alive, it's not a neutral. If you touch either one of those, they are going to be live, they are hot, and if you are earthed, you potentially are going to have a lot of energy traveling through you, which will either hurt or kill you. So just be very aware of that. That is obviously different from, I say, an outlet or having a neutral, where potentially a neutral in theory shouldn't be live. In theory shouldn't be. But in this case, very much both these feeds, line 1 and line 2, are live. So that was the key difference I wanted to point out, which potentially would cause confusion with folks who aren't in the US. And even if you are in the US, you just might not be familiar with the configuration of the electrical system. It is a little bit different. So the one thing I want to point out again about the bonding of the earth and the neutral, and what I want to do in another video, is actually do a practical demonstration. We'll perhaps look at the actual AC waves on an oscilloscope to see how the 240 is obtained with this kind of setup versus the 120 volt. We'll go through some practical demonstrations with what can go wrong, I'm going to discuss now. But the other thing to note is that, for instance, I talk about the bonding of the earth and the neutral, when you go to a sub panel, if you have a secondary panel that feeds off this, you have to be very careful with how that's wired. And that's why you need to speak to an electrician, because generally speaking, in a sub panel, you do not bond your ground and your neutral together. And there can be issues when you've got multiple grounds. Sometimes you might have a ground in your main panel, and then someone might want to have a ground in the secondary panel, and you need to be aware of when you can do that, because you can end up with ground loops, and you can have a potential difference between two grounds, and you can have current flowing in that, and that can result in all kinds of other problems. But anyway, let's get down to an interesting scenario that I came across when I was living here in a rental. One day we woke up in the morning. There had been a bit of a storm the previous night, and went to switch on the oven or the stove or the range. I don't know, there are different names for it. And it switched on, but it wasn't heating up. And I was like, that's odd. And then I discovered that some appliances weren't powering on at all. So I wonder, so this is a little riddle. If you want to jump in and post what you think the answer is, what was going on in that scenario, I'll give you a little more hint. I went to the breaker box thinking, well, some breaker must have tripped because some of the appliances weren't working. All the breakers were 100% in the on position where they should have been. So I eventually ended up calling out an electrical company. Well, because it was a rental, the rental company got an electrical company to come out and look at the problem. And what had happened during the night is from the transformer, which was feeding the house, one of the live feeds had broken. So basically, we had one of these lives break, and we had an open over here, a broken circuit on one of the live feeds. So what did that mean? So that meant basically that some of the 120 volt circuits, and I didn't mention this over here, What you generally try and do is you try and balance your 120 volt circuits. Because you've got these two feeds, you can have 120 volt circuits going across both of the live one and the live two. Now, when I say both, they can share the load across these feeds, and that's what you try and do to try and balance your load. So you haven't got one of these live feeds heavily loaded versus the other one. So you can balance the circuits across these two. And that's why in the house, for instance, if I had a load which was on that one live one and that circuit was broken, it didn't have an electrical feed, whereas another 120 volt circuit did. But you can have this odd scenario where you've still got, even though you haven't got a feed coming through that live one, you might have electricity coming through, passing through an appliance, just think like a light bulb, passing through there, and then coming through this circuit and still passing current through your 240 volt appliance. So it's still getting current, but not the required current. And that was the mystery. I was mystified when I saw that the oven coming on, but it just wasn't getting hot enough. And that was the reason. It was actually getting a feed which is being passed through an appliance which was still going through, connected to the neutral, connected with another appliance which was sharing that neutral, going across and through. So that was a really odd scenario which I certainly wouldn't have been aware of, that could occur from something as simple as one of the lives breaking. So here's the next riddle. There's a potential for an even worse case scenario than has happened here, which can potentially blow your appliances within your house. So here we go. What can potentially happen is if you end up with an open or disconnected neutral. So let's say I've got my live feed fine. Let's say there's a storm. And this is common in the US. It's surprising how often I would say I've had more brownouts and power failures here in the US than I have in South Africa. And that's saying something, because the power in recent years in South Africa has become very unreliable. But here in the US, because you've got a lot of power which is above ground, not underground, and you've got a lot of trees here in the US, there are trees being blown down in storms, and often power lines are being taken out and you get outages or brownouts or what have you. And what you can happen is a broken or open neutral. So if we do this, what happens then? Then you end up with a fairly nasty situation, because you've got your live one and your live two. So you've got your 240 volts coming through across here. And one would think, oh, well, then the 120 volt circuits aren't going to work. But what potentially could happen is you get the feed coming through here. Let's say, for instance, you've got an appliance connected. It's got a path to come across here. It's not going down the neutral to give it split voltage, that 120 volt. It's coming across here and has a path through another appliance through to the other live. So you can potentially have 240 volts or a far higher voltage now going across your appliances, which should have been receiving 120. And then you can have things like TVs and sensitive appliances blowing up or blowing the internals, because they're getting a far higher voltage than they should be, because the neutral is disconnected. So just something to be aware of. It might be an interesting one to troubleshoot if you suddenly have this issue where things are kind of half working and not working, or things are blowing. It can be something silly as either one of the lines being disconnected or a neutral being disconnected. So I thought what I'd also do is, just show you an interesting difference between the kind of what I'd call a plug from South Africa versus the US. Talk about some of the pros and cons. So you can see plugs around the world are very different in design, and they all have their pros and cons. Now, the South African one would seem to be quite large and cumbersome, but the one nice thing about this, it is similar to the UK design. The UK design will have rectangular sharp pins versus these round pins. But when you plug this into an outlet, it is held there nice and firmly. And that is the one thing I found frustrating about here in the States, is that when you have these plugged into a wall, there are several issues which arise. For one, it is a smaller prong layout. And when it goes in into one of these plugs, now this plug tends to have fairly good grip, but many of the plugs, these receptacles, don't. And if you've got any weight on your plug, you'll find these tend to dangle and pull out from the wall. And there's a couple of reasons that's happened. Because it's got a smaller footprint, you might not have a good outlet. And also what tends to happen is because you're mounting here in the US, you've got walls which are made of timber framing and drywall, the box that houses the actual outlet can often move as well. And so you have this scenario where trying to get your plug out, things move and things shift, and yeah, it's a niggle. The one nice thing about the US outlets is they cater for both 3-pin plugs and 2-pin. So if you have a 2-pin plug, they're designed to go straight in here. Whereas in, for instance, in South Africa, your 2-pin appliances, you just have two small pins. You need an adapter that you have to plug into your wall. And those can actually be quite loose and floppy about. It's a pity the South African 2-pin system didn't have something which went straight into these two. But the issue there, again, is controlling your neutral and your live. You've got two pins which are the same, whereas in the US outlet, you've got, they almost polarized. They are pins so that you, if you need to maintain your neutral and your live correctly, you can only put a two pin in one way. You do get some two pin plugs which don't have the larger pin, so you can put them in either way. But for the most part, they can be polarized so that they go in the right way. So they pick up the live correctly and they pick up a neutral correctly. Then the one other interesting thing I'll just point out about, let's say, breakers in the US versus South Africa. As noted, you have the system where you have a rail where this clips into and it pushes onto the conductor. You've got like a little spade connector here. I know the lighting isn't that great, but you have a spade which pushes in there and picks that up. And for the most part, the American breakers, you do get different types of breakers, but the breakers are set to break on overload only. You do get ones which can be set to break on ground faults and arc faults, but mostly it's on overload. Whereas in South Africa, most of your breakers will be in this configuration. They are set up so that they are mounted on a DIN rail. They don't pick up a general conductor to pick up the live. The lives come in separately through one side and then are switched, and then you go to your appliance or your outlet on this side. And for the most part, I think it does differ between lighting and circuits for appliances, but for the most part, the breakers will break on overload and earth leakage. So like this one is rated if it sees a differential of 30 milliamps. Now I think that is slightly higher than, let's say, the earth leakage ones in the US for bathrooms and what have you. But it has this built-in protection where it'll do an earth leakage trip as well as overload right in the breaker box, as opposed to having outlets. And I said, I know you certainly do get different breakers that you can have in your breaker box in the States, which do earth leakage or arc protection or what have you. The one downside of this, certainly in the South African setting, is that you can end up with a lot of nuisance trips. So if your house has got older wiring, and particularly in moist weather, there might be some earth leakage between wires, then you can get nuisance trips that way. You also have to balance your neutrals in your DB board. If they're not balanced, then you can get the incorrect differential in current, which can also end up tripping these. I've had a scenario like that when I was trying to install solar in one of our houses. The electrician was there trying to troubleshoot it, and it took quite a while to get the DB board sorted out before we could do the solar. So just before we move on also and just look at a potential issue with how you switch an outlet or what have you, what can go wrong in your household wiring, just to note, and this again is one of the reasons why I did this video, is you do get different colored wiring. As noted, like in South Africa, you're going to get a brown as your live and a blue as your neutral. I've seen that coloring here. Don't take, for example, I've seen some heavy gauge wire used for running well pumps, for instance, and the conductor colors in there may be black and white, but it's being used for 240 volt. So you mustn't go and think, oh, well, that white is not live and it's neutral. No, it's either live one or live two and the other live. So you just need to be very careful about the wiring in a house and how you go about doing it. And the best thing is certainly if you don't know what you're doing, don't go poking your fingers inside breaker boxes or DB boards.
Right, so before we end off and talk about electricians, let's just talk about the danger that can happen if wiring is not done correctly in a house and why you should always be careful about assuming whether a circuit is live or not live. And I'll paint a scenario. Let's say, for instance, that you need to go and do some electrical wiring. You're going to change a light fitting. So you've got light fittings. And the way it should be wired is that the switch on the wall should be switching live, right? So if you switch that live, you've got your live feed AC coming through here. It's switched on, it passes through your light bulb, your load, and then is returned through the neutral. If you go and switch this off at the wall and then go and work on this fitting, in theory, you should be fine. If you happen to get your fingers in there and touch the neutral, hopefully there's no load on the neutral, you should be okay. But what can happen, if someone has gone and mistakenly switched the live and the neutral, the switch will seemingly behave correctly. You'll have your live coming through here, but if the circuit is broken on the neutral side, the light will be off. And you'll think, everything's fine. When I switch the switch, the power goes off. And when I switch it on, the power goes on. So I switch it off, and then I decide to go and work on the circuit without going to the breaker box to actually kill the circuit. And look what's happening. Because your live is not being switched, when you go and put your hands or go and put a screwdriver and unscrew the screws, the live is still live because the switch happens to be on the neutral side. And you, if you happen to be earth yourself, which can happen very easily when you're holding, working on a fitting and you've got a hand somewhere else or your feet are somewhere which provide an electrical path through your body, you can get a nasty bite. You can potentially have a fatal bite. So just a little warning, be very wary of that. If you need to go and you decide you're not going to call an electrician, you're going to change a light fitting or doing something like that, go and make sure the circuits are off at the circuit board. Have a circuit tester. If you had a circuit tester in this circumstance, hopefully you'd pick up that thing's alive. But my advice to you is rather call someone professional. If they do something wrong and they get hurt, it is their responsibility. If they do something wrong to your wiring and something goes awry, there's some kind of recourse. But let's just chat about that. Okay, then. So I hope you found that informative. It was just a quick off-the-cuff video just to provide a little more context for some of you who might have been confused by the wiring system here. So it hopefully provides a bit more information on that. And as I said, please don't use this as a tutorial. It's merely a little guidance. But let's get down to the topic of using electricians. And I'm keen to hear your experiences throughout the world. It's very easy to say in these videos, well, certainly don't do it yourself. And I stand by that. If you don't know what you're doing and have no experience in this area, be very wary. You can quite easily miswire something. I know I've done some of these mistakes in the past myself. However, I think in all the properties I've owned, I've only known one electrician that actually came and did an excellent piece of work and a trustworthy piece of work. That was an electrician who came to add solar power to our house in Tumbus Kloof in Cape Town, which was the first house that we had solar powered. And he wasn't qualified. I'll say this much. He'd been doing electrical work in conjunction with solar power installations for many years. He had a good brain. He knew how to logically integrate these things, because it was tricky in terms of trying to have a system that interfaced with a grid in South Africa and could switch in and out under different situations. But since that, the electricians that I've come across have either, for instance, whether you've wanted a generator wired into your DB board or solar power wired in, I've sat there and these guys have not been able to work this out because it's just been something different from what they've done before. They haven't been able to get their heads around how to do the wiring. And I've had to jump in and go, this is how it's happening. Draw it out. You need to do this, and literally handhold and tell the guys how to do it. And that is scary because I am not qualified in this area. I've seen electricians, even potentially here in my cabin, there is a situation where I've seen something that's been wired not correctly. I know what it is, and I know what to watch out for. But it's the electrician did it, and it passed inspection. And this can so easily happen. And it's scary to me to see how many times, just in my own experience, I have seen this happen. So I'm keen to hear from yourselves, your own experiences with electricians. Are you an electrician? Is this something you see in your day-to-day work? Or if you've a homeowner or what have you, and you had electrical work done, and you've just had to really shake your head at what's happened. I'd be really keen to hear your input. But anyway, I do hope at some point in time to follow up with a more in-depth video where I lay out a practical demonstration of what can go awry. We use an oscilloscope to look at the signals on a split phase system, because the split phase system is, quite different from those in Europe or South Africa, for instance. But we'll do that in a future video. But anyway, thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.
Do consider using PCBWay for your next electronics project.